Good morning, and welcome to Conversations in Christ. We invite you to sit back, open your Bible, and engage in a dialogue as we learn together more about the incredible gift of grace that God has given all of us. Now, let's reason together in love.
Good morning, Donna.
Good morning, Billy.
Good morning, Carl.
Good morning, both of you.
Good morning, Carl.
Good morning, folks out there.
Good morning to all those people out there in TV land and radio land.
Radio land, yeah. Podcast land.
Yeah. All right. So we're continuing our series in The Old Man and the New Man.
old person, new person, to make it generic.
The new creation and the old creation. I mean, we can... There's the flesh and the non-flesh.
We're going to go through... We've got about... 30 passages we're going to go through in the next few months, and they all kind of focus on this contrast between the new person in Christ, which can't be improved because it's already perfect, and the old person in the flesh, which also can't be improved because it's already corrupt. And so when you learn the distinction between those two, and that's how the spiritual life works, that solves a lot of problems.
Just a personal note, I had a tremendous battle, before I understood this, and that battle was, I was always trying to perfect the flesh. Mm-hmm. And you're pretty much encouraged within church structures to focus in on sin and eliminate that. And there's a great deal of effort to focus on, you're improving your old creation, even though they don't see that or acknowledge it, but that's the focus of most teaching and most messages.
Yeah, and you can get enough accomplished doing that a little bit that it makes you feel like you're getting somewhere. It's kind of like a slot machine. You put the money in and it always gives you a little bit back to keep you going. So you battle the flesh and, boy, I'm really going to get better and I'm going to serve God and I'm going to do all these good things. They're all good things. But as we do that, it sucks up all our attention, all our focus. And by the way, I know Jesus and I walk in the Spirit and everything, but I really got to try harder. And all your time and energy goes into battling that, and you don't really get very far. You get just far enough and just successful enough to maybe look and feel better than somebody else. There's always somebody worse and somebody better. But man, this walking the instinctive life in Christ that we talked about a month or so ago, and then the mind of Christ, and now this new person you are in Christ, man, when you understand that stuff.
You'll get off the treadmill.
How about that?
Yeah, you'll actually get somewhere.
And you stop beating yourself up.
You stop beating yourself.
For a spiritual failure.
Yeah.
Hey, treadmill, wasn't that that book you recommended? I've got it on our book list. It's called How to Be a Christian Without Being Religious.
Ridenour.
And it's a really good book. It's kind of a teenage level book, but it's really a primer for
new believers.
Oh yeah, and it actually goes through the book of Romans.
Yeah,
which I'm doing on Wednesday nights on the Wednesday night Conversations in Christ on Zoom.
So out there in TV land, if people are wondering where these oranges came from, they came from off of Donna's tree.
So in Sacramento,
this is our pay today. one orange. We'll talk for an orange.
That's right.
Okay.
So, all right, we'll get into this study here. And we're looking at Colossians 3, 1 through 14. And we'll just go into some verses 1 through 3 this morning. And look at how this new creation, this new man or new woman has been placed in Christ and has been given us the ability to live the spiritual life. And so when Paul starts out in verse 1 in chapter 3, he just says, "If or since then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory."
Says it all. We could just stop the series now. Here's what to seek and get your eyes on.
Yeah. And he starts out by just saying, remember, we've all been raised with Christ.
Yes.
And we've discussed this in the past where, at the time when Jesus went to the cross, you know, when he died, we died with him. When he was buried, we were buried with him. And when he raised, and we were raised with him. And so there's this complete participation that went on that moment on the cross, where we're proactive, we're contributing and participating with that whole process of him going to the cross and post-cross. And so Paul starts out and just says, remember, you've been raised with Christ. And so since then, seek the things that are above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. And so there you go. I mean,
that's the unseen world, though, and it's not the physical world. It reminds me of when you were talking about the engineer mind of what you can see and what you can touch.
Yep.
But this takes it all into the faith, the unseen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's more real than this.
For a lot of people, it is.
Yeah.
Well, grasping
and
this.
It probably should be, and it will be someday.
It is.
Right now, it's a struggle for a lot of people. They're going, well, I can see this, and I can measure this. That's, and I sympathize with them, because when you go to a church and hear a sermon, they can't prove any of it. Now, you might hear it and say, I agree with that, and I believe it to be true, but they can't prove. You can't prove the resurrection. You can't prove the Bible is the Word of God. You can't. Those are all faith things.
But when you see this, though, you can't unsee it.
Well, that's
because,
true.
Because the mind is already there.
There is another set of eyes that we all have.
That's right. And
but they're very personal. And so what I see spiritually, I can't take my spiritual eyes out and give them to somebody else. All I can do is tell them about
but
it.
But that's what he says here. Set your minds on things that are
above. Set your mind and your eyes.
Yes.
So that's how I see the New Testament. It's a testament. It's a testimony given by people who lived a long time ago. And that's great. And read it and listen to them. At some point, you got to close the book and say, now that I got this testimony from them, I need to get my own spiritual eyes. Because theirs won't do
that's
for
right.
me.
That's right.
I mean, it's great they got theirs, and I think they might be right, and it's really impressive, and that makes sense to me, and I read Paul, and he's connecting with me, but at some point, I got to get my own. And that's why you got to spend time alone with God.
That's right.
Yeah.
Nobody can do it for you.
Mm-mm.
Yeah. So when Paul says, so set your minds on the things that are above, what do you think he's talking about then?
That's a Donna question.
Well, that's what I was thinking about. I was kind of jumping the gun. Mm-hmm. That's what I think. What do you think?
I took a little bit of time just to throw in Philippians 4:8-9. And this is what I was thinking that Paul might be referring to in Philippians 4. He says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you.
And those are all internal things. They can be manifested outwardly, but...
Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, sounds like positive thinking to me.
Kind of.
No, but it is.
It is positive.
People will knock that
it
and
is.
Go, oh, that's secular. And I go, but it's true. Mm-hmm. But if you ask Paul, hey, that's pretty positive thinking. Yeah. Dwell on things that are
but
good.
Think about this. Paul came out of deep understanding, or Saul came out of deep knowledge of the Torah, of Genesis and of mm-hmm. all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So he had to follow the letter of the law and to think about things in a totally different way. I mean, what a contrast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm sure he'd say, well, you dwell on positive things, whether it's in the Torah or not.
Right, but what I'm saying, yes, that's where the foundation was. Mm-hmm. And then when the scales fell off his eyes, He was able to appreciate the reality of who God really is.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
And in a way you can't.
He couldn't under all that law. He
not
couldn't.
Really. Not under the law.
No.
And even without the law, just as in a material world, you still can't.
But he was so schooled with all that.
Yeah.
I mean, I appreciate all that I learned as a child in the church. It was all legalistic, but I learned so many verses. Yeah. Well, then when the scales fell off my eyes, I understood what it meant on a totally different...
Oh, the verses get new meaning.
Like the, another layer.
Yeah, I think it's more encompassing of all of the New Testament and all that it presents God to be, that he's this wonderful Savior. Yeah, he does judgment, accurate assessment. Mm-hmm. He does those things. Those are clear. But you don't focus on those. You go, well, those have to fit into who he is, his high moral excellence, his love. Those things fit into that. You don't go the other way around. He's a God of judgment and condemnation. And by the way, he also loves you if he has to. It's the other way around. But we're so drawn to negative in medical things, in life, in politics, at church, religion, negative cells. Mm-hmm. It appeals to us in some weird way. And to break out of that and dwell on things that are good, Paul says, wow, that'll change your life.
That's the solution.
And that's the basis of this new creation or this new man, is that once you understand that is the substance of who we are 24/7, and mm-hmm. when God is looking at us, he's not looking at the negative stuff that you were just mentioning, mm-hmm. you know, in our lives. He's looking at this new creation made in the very image and likeness of Jesus Christ. And that is all that he relates to. And, you know,
it's all he relates to. Now, he knows the negative's there, but he wants it to go. It's not like he doesn't, not aware of it and doesn't see it. He sees it and he goes, that's junk. That needs to go. That's that old person in your life, the old nature. I'm going to do everything it takes to eventually get that to be gone from your life because I want you to be whole and to be saved, to be redeemed, to be restored. That's my goal. My goal isn't to condemn you. It's to save you. And I'm going to do whatever it takes as long as it takes. And I've got all time and all resources to do it.
Mm-hmm.
He won't fail.
Yeah. You know, and what's good about these verses in Philippians 4 is there's nothing negative there. And so we have, since we're seated with Christ, now we can seek the things that are above. That's all about what he's done in our lives. And so Paul's just saying, so since all this has been taken care of for you, now set your minds on the things that are above. And so we're able to do that because of this new creation that's been made in Christ. And so we can not have to focus on the negative, because if we're focusing on the negative, all that's going to do is empower negative behavior.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he doesn't even give a list of what not to focus on, because then we'd start focus on what we shouldn't focus on.
Yeah.
And really, all the negatives are just an absence of these things. So they're not real. There's just something missing. So he goes, let's dwell on what is substantial, the substance, the good things. Because God is good and he brings good things and they're all around us. They're part of the world, and we miss out on it by dwelling on things that really don't exist. They're just an absence of the good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then he says, now keep in mind, you know, you've been raised with Christ. And then verse 3, he says, and also remember, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And so that old man or that old creation has died.
Right.
It's no longer even a part of our spiritual nature.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's been replaced by this new creation. And then he goes, and it's so complete that your life has been hidden in Christ with God. And so you have to take a look at what he's done here, and we've been totally immersed into Jesus Christ's life. Everything about us now is hidden in him. And that's the positive thing, is that now God is always just looking at his son, and we're hidden in his son. It's hard to explain.
It's hard to imagine hidden.
Well, it's what he sees, and it's what matters to him, and it's what's real. But we don't realize it. often, not fully. We don't always experience it. And that's why he has to say something like, hey, focus on Christ, because we don't. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's still lingering around, but it's not the real thing. It's the illusion of wrong things and sin, which we do, but focusing on that distracts us from the very thing that will save us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and when you think about being hidden with Christ and God, all of who Jesus Christ is, his holiness, yep, his righteousness, his justice, his peace, all of that is now immersed into our lives. We're commingled together.
Well, this is the dilemma. We are there. That's all true. It's real. And yet we don't fully experience it. So it seems like it's not. Or it seems like, certainly experientially, we're kind of in both worlds. And we'll get into that more and more. This is always a constant battle. But it can be won. It has been won, actually, with God on the cross. Mm-hmm. We don't take advantage of it. We don't realize it. We don't experience it. But that's all available to us now in varying degrees. And the more you move toward that new person you are in Christ and focus on that, walk in the Spirit and you won't fulfill the desires of the flesh. That's about how simple it is. Then you gain. Otherwise, you get sucked into this downward spiral that you can get out of. It's not a downward spiral you can't get out of, but a lot of people are in that.
Yeah, and a lot of people too, when you're in this battle of trying to improve that old creation, it's so self-defeating because you can't improve it, yet we work really hard at trying to do that. And so we think the Christian life is theoretically the moral life. And, mm-hmm. yeah. and Jesus didn't come along to teach morality.
Teach morality.
Yeah. You know, he wanted to express this exchange life that we could have with him. And that exchange life is what Paul's talking about here. Our life is hidden with him. So since it is, that should be a great encouragement for people who think that their spirituality is dependent upon them. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, it's so easy to focus on sin and mistakes and defeats and discouragements and think, well, that's all that there is about this life, and that's all that God is seeing is that. And when you realize that he sees that, he's not ignoring that, but his 100% of his focus is on his son, and we're hidden with him, and that's our identity.
Yes, and we're free to live. We're free. We're not in the bondage anymore. Because even moral people can be in bondage.
And they can be free, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's going back to, you know, what last week we were talking about holiness and stuff like that. And I had asked you the question, so do you see yourself as holy as Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes and no.
And our behavior.
Depends on which man I'm looking at.
Yeah.
We're not supposed to look at the man. It's it.
And you're right. We're not supposed to focus on it, but you got to recognize it and say, yeah, that's like John says in 1 John, if you say you're without sin, you're a liar.
Yeah.
You're not fake. So you say, yeah, I'm a sinner. Okay, move on now. Now that you've acknowledged it, because you got to acknowledge it, now you can go focus on being the new person you are in Christ. And that's where the victory's won. In fact, it's already won. Mm-hmm. We're like people going around trying to win a victory that's already
so
won.
So we are as holy as Christ.
Yeah, 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 we are.
Because he doesn't look at the old
right. We don't always act like it. We don't always experience it. But we are actually, we are in who we have become, who he's made us to be. And it's the power of what happened on the cross. It was all done there.
Yeah.
People way, way underestimate and sell short what Christ did on the cross. It was finished. He did a complete work there for all humanity. We just don't all know about it. We don't all experience it, but it's been done. And really, you know, you said, you know, it is partly up to us, probably in the most minimal sense, not, oh, I got to go quit sinning, But in that little small part of I'm going to yield to you, that we can hang on to and cause trouble. But that's not really that much. It just looms big to us.
Well, what that will do is make your life easier while you're here in the flesh. It just makes your life easier, but it has nothing to do with...
No, it doesn't have to do anything
with anything. So if you want your, you know, life to run more smoothly and you're more at peace,
listen
to the Holy Spirit and not get caught up with... Well, I think it goes back to what Bill had said before about being comfortable with, we have flesh. It's what it is. So move on.
Yeah. And that flesh
is
old man.
I don't think about it. I really don't.
Yeah. And the victory over that.
It's already been done.
Yeah. Yeah. And the victory is just exactly what Paul's talking about here. If I focus on that old creation, that old man, it's just going to be so defeating.
It'll weigh you down.
But if the majority of my attention can be focused on this new creation and what God has created within all of us, when I focus on that, that takes my eyes off of temptation, sin, my mistakes, my inabilities. And so I see, you know, how God views me. And that gives me a lift in life and a confidence to keep going.
Yeah. And it's not like nobody out there is doing this or that we're the only three.
Mm-hmm.
We're not. There are tons of people in all different degrees from the secular world that there are people who are actually living in the new person they are in Christ and don't realize it because they're doing good things and they're dwelling on what's good. And there are people who go to church and are spiritual and are living a defeated life. And there's everything in between. There are people partly there. There are people growing in this. All I can do is say, I used to be further away from this and now I live in it more. And as I've gotten older, it's gotten better. And that's what it is. It's a growth process. Mm-hmm. And it's not, I'm there and you're not. It's I'm here now and I didn't used to be here. And I'm going to be doing better in the future.
Yeah.
That's really what you can you can conclude.
Yeah. And I used to, you know, look at people. You were either born again or you weren't. And, you know, and then I would see these friends of mine who were living great lives, contributing to society, productive. They didn't believe in God, and I couldn't fault them for how they were living their life and what they were doing for other people and loving people. And then now that I see that everybody's got that new creation inside of them, and they can they're all doing things, even though like what you're saying, they may not be experiencing God's vision.
They might not be conscious of it.
No, but
something's going right for
them. God is living within them, and He's motivating them into a certain direction, and they're producing sometimes greater things than even we're doing as believers.
That's right.
So,
because God's doing it, He's working in them.
Yeah,
they might not be conscious of it or realize it, but they will someday. Mm-hmm. And it's a big spectrum. And it's not, you know, we want to divide into two groups of people, the sheep and the goats, and we'll get into that, old, new and old man. And usually that, the motive of that, I believe, is when you're in a group of religious people, you want to have the in crowd and the out crowd. Because it separates you, it makes you special and better and all that kind of stuff, and makes a distinction. And it binds people into the religious structure, which is really a bondage. It's really a trapping. When you realize it's a big spectrum, that God's at work in everybody's life.
That's right.
And yeah, some people are believers and some aren't. I understand that. I've been a non-believer and I've been a believer. But God is always at work in me. And it's just, where am I on that spectrum? And it's not two groups of people where He loves one group and He's going to send the rest to hell forever. That's nonsense. He loves everybody, loves His whole world, and He's working in everybody's life. And yeah, some people are further along. I'm further along than I used to be. But it doesn't matter if I'm further along than somebody else. Maybe I'm not. Maybe just in certain areas, right? Maybe I'm failing in other areas. It doesn't matter.
Yep.
It's what's going on between me and God right now, and you and God and the other person. So I just go around encouraging people.
Everybody has an inner voice, even if they think they don't think there's a God.
Yeah.
There's an inner voice going on in it, in within them. And that's God talking.
You know, I've been reading up on Buddha. You know, he was 500 years before Christ. So he didn't have Jesus to, you know, didn't have no knowledge of that. He was in India, didn't have any knowledge of the Jews. It was really a small group of people.
That's right.
All he had was look at the world and listen to any inner voice that God might give him and try to rationally think. And he actually came up with some pretty good conclusions. You need to go with the flow. There's this big reality out there. I don't know what to call it, but let's try to embrace that. I think he was reaching out to God in his own way that he could in that time. That's why we need Jesus to come and
God
say,
had reached out to him.
Here's so the Father.
Oh, we're running out of time.
How about that? Well, listen, let me just end this. ConversationsInChrist.net is our website. Get on there, look at our resources, give us feedback, good, bad, indifferent. We'd love to hear from you. And we'll continue this next week.
Bye, folks.
Okay, thanks. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to Conversations in Christ. Our prayer is that today's program has opened your heart and mind to a greater understanding and curiosity about the gift of grace that God has given to each of us in and through His Son, Jesus Christ. Remember, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing by God, so that you may believe and begin to experience the very life of God in you. Tune in again next week for Conversations in Christ.
If you have a comment or a question, we would love to hear from you. You can contact us at conversationsinchrist.net. That's conversationsinchrist.net.